हवा
हवा
में
जल के हवाले से नीचे होता है।
नमस्कार प्रोफेसर तनिजा।
नमस्कार जी, नमस्कार नौटियाल जी।
डॉक्टर कविता शर्मा, डॉक्टर यादव, डॉक्टर मलिक, डॉक्टर
नमस्कार।
आशीष आगरा, नमस्कार जी।
गुड इवनिंग सर।
गुड इवनिंग।
इवनिंग। गुड इवनिंग।
हाँ जी, हाँ जी सर। तो अभी 2-3 मिनट में स्टार्ट कर देते हैं।
चार बजे में 2-3 मिनट है, 3 मिनट का नहीं। सर ऑलमोस्ट टाइम हो रहा है, कैन वी स्टार्ट सर?
I think there are still 3 minutes to go.
कविता मैम
अनुज जी, अनुज कुमार, कविता मैम स्टार्ट कर दीजिए।
On the behalf of organizing committee of this lecture series, express heartfelt greetings to all of you. First of all, a very good evening to everyone. As we all know, we all joined on this platform for the third lecture of Vikram Sarabhai Bird Centenary Lecture Series on the topic Science and Science Temper, Vigyan Tatha Vaigyanik Soch by Dr. Chandra Mohan Nautiyal. We feel very much motivated and honored to have our Honorable Vice Chancellor Professor N.K. Taneja, Pro Vice Chancellor Madam Vimala Bai, our invited speaker Dr. C.M. Nautiyal, and a hefty number of faculties, research scholars, and students joined us. With the kind permission of Honorable Vice Chancellor, let us start the lecture session. And before starting the lecture, we begin with the Vandana of Ma Saraswati. And for this, I would like to invite Ms. Lavista Tyagi, student of MSc fourth semester. Let us pray before Ma Saraswati. Lavista, please continue. Lavista, please unmute your mic first.
Thank you, ma'am. Om Shri Ganeshaya Namaha. Saraswati Namastubhyam Varde Kamal.
She is again muted. Dr. Updesh, please unmute her.
She is a co-host. She can unmute themselves.
Okay. Lavista, please start again.
Okay, ma'am. Ya Kundindu Tushara Hara Dhavala Ya Shubhra Vastra Vrita Ya Veena Varadanda Mandita Kara Ya Shweta Padmasana Ya Brahma Chuta Shankara Prabhriti Bhi Devai Sada Vandita Samam Patu Saraswati Bhagavati Nishesha Jadya Paham
Thank you very much, Lavista, for this beautiful singing. Now, for the further proceedings, I would like to invite Professor Anil Malik. Please continue with the session.
Thank you, Dr. Kavita. Professor N.K. Taneja, sir, Honorable Vice Chancellor, Choi Charan Singh University, Meerut, a dynamic leader and a very good administrator. Professor Vimala Bai, Pro Vice Chancellor, CCS University, Meerut. K. Gupta, probably he has not joined, Dean Science, CCS University, Meerut. S.P. Khare, Founder Head, Physics Department. Today's invited speaker, Dr. C.M. Nautiyal, a famous, eminent physicist. And dear, good evening. I express a very warm welcome to you all. I am pleased to mention that this is Golden Jubilee year of Physics Department and also the birth centenary year of Padam Vibhushan, great Indian space scientist and father of Indian space program, Professor Vikram Sarabhai. Dedicated to both the auspicious reasons, Department of Physics plan to organize the Vikram Sarabhai birth centenary lecture series. The inaugural lecture of this series was delivered by Professor J.J. Rawal, renowned cosmologist and former director Nehru Planetarium, Mumbai. Second lecture was delivered by Professor Valery Tuchin, honorary chair of Saratov State University, Russia. Today, we all are connected on this platform for the third popular lecture although first online of this series to be delivered by Dr. C.M. Nautiyal ji. Dr. Nautiyal is recently retired from BPL Sahni Institute of Paleo Science, Lucknow. It is my pleasure to share that we both have common alma mater during our MSc programs. He is also from IIT Roorkee, MSc from IIT Roorkee. It is also my privilege to give a brief introduction about our department with the due permission of the chair. This department was set up in the year 1969 under the dynamic leadership of Professor S.P. Khare. The department offers MSc, MPhil, and PhD programs. At present, there are 7 faculty members. Department received an approximately amount of rupees 2 crore under DST FIST scheme. Research projects of amount rupees 76 lakhs funded by SARB, DHR, ICMR, and UGC are undergoing. 2 research projects, one under BRICS multilateral scheme and one under SARB CRG scheme of approximately 4.5 crores are under review. 5 years, faculty members have published more than 75 research papers in international journals with SCI Q1 rating. 2 of our faculty members received prestigious Raman Fellowship Award for doing research in USA. We have developed research facilities like RF sputtering, 1000 level clean room facility, photolithography, atomic force microscopy, SAM, TAM, photoluminescence, etc. Very soon, a high level computing facility for research simulations is going to be established. At present, we have 30 PhD students registered in our department. All could have been possible with the motivation and kind support of our Honorable Vice Chancellor, Professor N.K. Taneja, sir. It is worth mentioning here about the activities of our department carried out during the stressful time of COVID-19 pandemic. During this period, we successfully carried out theory classes in online mode. The worst hit part of our curriculum, the laboratory experiments for MSc students, were carried out using available softwares based virtual platforms, which recently have been included in the new education policy. We also organized an international e-conference entitled Prospective of Interdisciplinary Research in Science and Technology in Present Scenario on May 15, 2020. We received an overwhelming response across India. It was completely green conference with very low cost. Although registration in this conference was free, but we were able to raise a fund of rupees 51,415 to the PM CARES Fund. On behalf of all faculty members, I can assure that we will work even harder to bring our department and university to the new higher level. Thank you, sir. I welcome again all of you. Professor Anuj, I request you to please take over. Dr. Anuj.
Thank you, Professor Malik. Honorable Vice Chancellor, Professor N.K. Taneja ji, Professor Bai Bimla, ma'am, Honorable Dovai Vice Chancellor, Professor M.K. Gupta, Dean, Science Faculty, the speaker of today's lecture, Dr. C.M. Nautiyal ji, distinguished colleagues, guests, and dear students. The topic of the lecture today is the science and scientific temper, Vigyan Tatha Vaigyanik Soch. This lecture will be delivered by a prominent scientist, Dr. Chandra Mohan Nautiyal ji. I feel privileged in introducing the speaker of today, Dr. Chandra Mohan Nautiyal ji. He is basically a physicist. After BSc honors in physics, he has done MSc from IIT Roorkee. He pursued doctoral and postdoctoral studies at PRL Ahmedabad. As a student, he received 5 scholarships and fellowships, and later INSA DFG fellowship to work at Max Planck Institutes at Heidelberg and Mainz. He He was awarded the most coveted and prestigious INSA medal for young scientists by Indian National Science Academy. He has also won prizes for his papers from Indian Society for Mass Spectrometry, the Paleobotanical Society and Meteorology Society USA, and Consultancy Medal from BSIP. He was a scientific collaborator in Lunar Science Program for NASA's Moon Sample Studies. His research spans a wide area from astrosciences, earth sciences, paleoclimate, and archaeology. He has been reviewer of several renowned research journals. Apart from more than 70 research papers and 60 research abstracts in mostly reputed international journals, he has written about 70 popular articles, a dozen chapters in books, encyclopedias, and delivered over 800 lectures. He has lectured to a variety of audiences, such as the scientists at TIFR, ISC, IUSC, ASI, JNU, PRL, and the faculty and the staff of various training colleges, civil servants, and dozens of university students, lakhs of university students and teachers in big and small cities and places. This is what sets him apart from most scientists. In popularizing science, he has been involved in programs with Bharat Ratna, Dr. Kalam, Bharat Ratna, Professor Siana Rao, Padma Bhushan, Professor Espal, Padma Bhushan, Professor Navlikar, Padma Bhushan, Professor Masailkar, and many more. He has commented live on many TV channels on partial and total solar eclipses, lunar eclipses, science train, Venus transit, and joined about 200 radio and TV programs. He has been on many national committees, including advisory, selection, science and engineering project selection, and conference organizing committees. He has been honored by dozen other organizations for his research and science communication achievements. He has visited many institutions in France, Russia, South Africa, USA, UK, Germany, Vietnam, Switzerland, and many more. Dr. Nautiyal superannuated in 2016 as a head of radiocarbon lab of Weaver Sahani Institute of Paleosciences, Lucknow. He is still very active and doing research and delivering lectures. After his superannuation, he has published more than 8 research papers and is still writing for the radio and TV programs. Before I request the speaker for delivering his lecture, I like to put on record my heartfelt thanks to our Honorable Vice Chancellor, Professor N.K. Taneja ji, for presiding over this talk despite of his busy, very busy schedule. Professor Taneja does not require any introduction. He is a great academician and a vibrant leader. Apart from his own subject, economics, which he has taught for large number of years as a professor, he also has an equal command on other areas of education, humanities, and social sciences. His love for sciences, especially for physics, is well known to all of us. Under his leadership as a vice chancellor for the Charan Singh University, Meerut, university has achieved many milestones, for a name a few, like the Nakal Vihin Pariksha, transparent evaluation process, regular academic sessions, student-centric and student-friendly education system. He has been very instrumental in improving the academic environment of the campus and encouraging the teaching and research activities. With these words, I request Honorable VC Sir to shower all of us with his blessings and share his words of wisdom and encouragement. VC Sir, please.
Thank you, Dr. Anuj Kumar. In this very important lecture organized by Department of Physics of this university, present here are Professor S.P. Khare, the former head of the Department of Physics, rather the founder of this illustrious department of our university, Pro Vice Chancellor Professor Y. Vimla, eminent botanist, Dean, Faculty of Science Professor M. K. Gupta, Professor Anil Malik, Dr. Anuj Kumar. I could see the Dean, Faculty of Commerce of our university, Dr. Sudhir Kumar, also present here. Through this brief intervention, I extend a very warm welcome to Dr. Chandramohan Nautiyal, the eminent speaker this afternoon, a very old friend of mine of mid-1970s, Indian College, Meerut, where he was junior to me by 1 year in studies, but certainly much more senior to me in co-curricular activities. Blessed with very fine qualities of head and heart, he has definitely risen to the fame which he richly deserves. Even after his formal retirement, he is very vigorously pursuing the cause of science. The topic that he has chosen today is very dear to him, as I keep on following or trailing his remarks in the social media groups that he leads in many ways. At this juncture, it is very essential to understand the nature of science. But before I dwell on this, I would like to convey my respectful regards to Professor S.P. Khare, who laid the foundation of this department, which is doing a very good work even today. It is an established scientific fact that present is rooted in the past. The present achievements of this department speak volumes of the quality of the work that was done by this department during roughly 40 years of stay of Professor S.P. Khare as a very active researcher in physics. I am really thankful to him on behalf of the university community that he has come to bless us on this occasion. So far as science is concerned, I think as a student of science, most of us may be astonished as to how economics is being termed as science. I have deliberately used the word as a student of science. This is because of the simple fact that the unity of all science consists in its method alone, not in its material. Carl Pearson, the accomplished scientist, published a very famous book, Grammar of Science, in 1892. He was a professor of mathematics and applied mechanics in University College of London. And he remarked there that the classificatory approach to science is categorizing certain branches of knowledge as science and others as arts or humanities or commerce or business management for that matter. But he underlined that this is an erroneous approach. As a matter of fact, all knowledge applied to the process of solving the problems confronted by the mankind at large is essentially scientific in nature. So everyone who collects facts, analyzes them, sees their interrelationships and sequences, is applying the scientific method, is essentially a man of science. These facts may belong to past history of mankind, to social statistics of our great cities, to digestive organs of a worm, to atmosphere of distant stars, or to scarcely visible bacillus. It is not the fact themselves, but the method by which they are dealt with gives them the status of science. So science is an approach. Science is an attitude. Being inquisitive is the starting point of developing a scientific temper. This acquiescence or inquisitiveness needs to be aroused in young minds, and they need to be encouraged to observe facts objectively, apply established tools of analysis to see their interrelationships. The tools of analysis may be, the facts may be collected either through experimentation. The experimentation may be the controlled setting of a laboratory as in physics or in chemistry, or the experimentation may involve assessment of certain policies by different political structures in the world. All these facts, when analyzed in the context of conceptualizing a cause and effect relationship, and then reviewing as to which is the cause and which is the effect, is all scientific endeavor. I would like to remark at this juncture that it is for the first time that the need has been felt by the policymakers in Ministry of Human Resource Development of this government. And as a result, it has been made very clear that the scientific fervor or the scientific temper of school-going children needs to be harnessed, needs to be cultivated. As a result, under Atal Innovation Mission in 2015, Atal Tinkering Labs were established in remote areas of rural India, and large number of students in those dwellings were encouraged to work on machines, to work on scientific principles of physics, to solve practical problems with the help of those models, and to arouse their inquisitiveness. I am sure these efforts will go a long way in promoting the cause of science. The day is not far off when India will be able to achieve its past glory in creation of world-class knowledge. With these words, I wish this lecture or this series goes a long way in harnessing the scientific attitude of our young students. Dr. Nautiyal is an authority in this subject, and I chose to speak first simply because of this reason that it would have been very difficult for me to add anything to what he would have said. And I would like to be excused for this. I don't want to stand between you and the learned speaker, and I invite him to take the session on. I'll be now sitting as a patient listener. Thank you all.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir, for nice words and explaining the emphasis of the scientific temperament in the students. As we all now we can understand that scientific temperament is the one requirement which all the students must have, so that whatever they learn, maybe in any area of the maybe so-called science or art or maybe some other area of studies, they should be able to apply the basic knowledge of analyzing things. So with these words, thank you once again, sir. Now I would like to invite the speaker for today, Dr. C.M. Nautiyal ji, for delivering his talk. I want to mention one point to all the audience, that at the end of this talk, we will take few questions. And these questions, people are expected to put these questions in the chat box, so that we can, depending upon the availability of time, we can select few questions for the answers to be given by this expert. So With these words, I again invite Dr. Nautiyal ji for delivering his talk. Nautiyal sir.
Thank you, Dr. Anuj, for the invitation. Honorable Vice Chancellor Professor Narendra Taneja, Pro VC Professor Vimlaji, the founding father of this department, Professor S.P. Khare, the deans, Dr. Gupta and Dr. Sudhir, Professor Malik, I think Professor Birpal Singh is not here right now, and Dr. Anuj Gupta and other colleagues and many students. I'm going to talk to you about a subject about which we don't really talk too much. But Professor Taneja has so beautifully explained the philosophy of science and scientific temper that I don't think I need add anything further to that. As you said, this is a way of life. It's a method which is more important than what you achieve using those methods. In fact, in any realm of life, the approach becomes very important, be it sociology, be it science, or be any other discipline. So what I will do during the course of this lecture in 40 or 45 minutes, I'll be discussing some incidents where we saw how the scientific approach or the logical thinking can help us get out of that situation. We will take a few examples. I'll be using a PPT and I'll be sharing the screen. And we'll be discussing how scientific thinking helps us. But this is a month when... this is a month when the birthday of Professor Sarabhai falls on 12th of August. And I feel specially elated to be here on this occasion because Professor Sarabhai was the founder of the institution where I did my doctoral and postdoctoral work. That is a physical research laboratory at Ahmedabad. What you see here is Professor Sarabhai, and at the bottom you see the front building of the institution, PRL, or the Physical Research Laboratory. And the main building is behind that, an 8-storied building. And it may be pleasant for you to hear that Professor Kasturi Rangan, whose report was just mentioned a few minutes back, the new education policy, who chaired that committee, he also used to sit on the third floor of that building. And Professor U.R. Rao, the former chairman of ISRO, was also there. And they all moved to Bangalore around 1973. So I really feel happy that Professor Taneja, Professor Birpal Singh, and you people have invited me to a lecture series in the memory of Professor Dr. Vikram Sarabhai. Our country is a very special country with a very long history. This is an ancient country with a diversity of cultures, with a diversity of many specializations. And in fact, we have had a very, very long history in science and technology. If you look at our country, we have had satellites launched into space. We have had some of the most beautiful buildings. We have had many achievements in biosciences, in physical sciences, in chemical sciences, and also in engineering and technology. But the fact is that when the Apple was launched and the satellite was carried to its launching place, it was carried on a bullock cart because there were no roads in our country in that time. That was almost 30 years ago. We have temples in our country where milk is fed to rats. We still have a lot of problems of hygiene and sanitation, but despite all these handicaps, we have been able to launch in space. We have been able to launch many other projects and missions which did us proud. I will like to also mention something in our culture of science in our country, like Jantar Mantar. These were kind of observational observatories for observations of sun and stars and all, made by Savai Jai Singh. And not just in one places, it's more than one places. And in Delhi, in fact, you can see it very close to the Cannot Place even now. We had Aryabhatta in the 5th century AD, not many of us know that what we call Arabic numerals were actually invented in our country, but because they went to the West through Arabic people, therefore they are known as Arabic numerals. We did not have very high technology, but still Arafat was able to estimate the diameters of Earth and Moon. He was able to describe the axial rotation of Earth. We knew about the heliocentric solar system, which many people in Europe used to think that Earth is in the center of the solar system. The value of pi was found in our country much before in any other Western or any other country. His book, Aryabhatiya, is a book containing 121 shlokas in Sanskrit, and treatise on it has been published by the Indian National Science Academy. It's a small book. And even the decimal was discovered or invented in India. And some of you might have seen a paper in Nature just 3 years back, where they said that actually decimal was found something like 500 years before people thought it was found. And this was based on the radiocarbon dating of some ancient manuscript. So we had such a bright past, but we cannot sit on that. What I feel is that sometimes when we talk of about our past achievements, I think we must keep one thing in mind. We should only talk about those things which have evidence. Science is based on evidence. We may have a conviction that we had many other things, but I think we make ourselves a laughing stock if we talk about things for which we don't have an evidence. And that is, I think, where I differ from some other people. In the second century AD, in the fourth century AD, we had Sushrut and Charak. These people were able to describe 300 procedures of surgery, 121 instruments, and the operations included the surgery of nose, rhinoplasty, and they all have been described in the Sushrut Sahita, and these are well documented things of which we are proud. Ayurveda touched new heights during that period. But then in that country, we believe so much in rumors, we believe so much in things which are not scientific, that one message comes on one person's mobile that Ganeshji's Murti is drinking milk, and a lot of people run and try to feed milk to Ganeshji's statue. A lot of physicists are here, so it's not difficult for them to understand why that happens. Basically, this is surface tension because of attraction between milk and the material of the statue, and this can be explained very scientifically. But still, many of us believed very sincerely that this was a real event and the statues were drinking milk. I think as scientists, as physicists, it's our duty to explain to people that no, this was not true. Science, we should study, science we study, because sometimes knowing science can save one's life. In 1984, on that dirty day of December 3rd, when there was an unfortunate incident in Bhopal, which is known as MIC. Now, in that case, if people would have just moved not in the direction of the wind, but opposite to the wind, perhaps many lives would have been saved. People also tell me that if they could keep wet cloth over their mouth and face, many lives could have been saved. But this is hindsight. What I feel is that if there are some such common things to save somebody, the science communicators and the scientists should get together and they should talk to people about them. Nobody knows when an emergency comes. In our culture, covering mouth or covering face was a part. For example, the Jain Munis used to do it all the time. Then there was a practice of quarantine. Earlier, people very often used to die because of diseases which are infectious. And after somebody's death, the person who had been close to that person used to be in quarantine for 12 or 13 days. I think that quarantine and the value of that quarantine, people are now realizing. What I am trying to say is that there were many traditions in our country which were very scientific, but over time, even though we were practicing them, we did not know the scientific basis behind them. And today, in many of those good practices, bad practices have been mixed, and it has become very difficult to find out one from the other. So there is a need also to look for those practices and try to find if they have scientific basis. Isaac Asimov, a famous astronomer, he had said, a public that does not understand how science works, that person can get confused and all too easily can fall prey to those ignoramuses who make fun of what they don't understand, or to the sloganeers who proclaim scientists to be the mercenary warriors of today and the tools of the military. The difference between understanding and not understanding science is also the difference between respect and admiration on one hand and hate and fear on the other. And I think this sums up how people, or the common man, looks at science. The Article 51AH in the Indian Constitution has a very special statement which all of us must know. And they say that this is the fundamental duty of all the citizens to promote scientific temper, humanism, and spirit of inquiry. But then a non-science person asks, why should public know about science and technology? People should know and support science and technology because it affects the quality of life. It is helpful in leading a healthy life. It's also very important for the mental health of the society because many of our problems are because of our biases and unscientific thinking. Scientific thinking, learning the scientific method, promotes curiosity and logical thinking. And I think these two things can take care of many of our social problems. Science promotes industry, technology, and economy. And it's science and technology that comes to the rescue in case of emergency like we are facing today, the COVID-19 situation. It's not the God-men who are helping us, it's the doctors, it's the scientists, it's the people who are working in these subjects, the immunology or the different health sciences. But we should also distinguish science from technology. We should also be able to distinguish genuine research from the marketing research. So often in the newspapers today, these days you find chocolate is good for health, or coffee is good for health, or oil will not increase cholesterol. Now, these are all gimmicks of marketing. Oil cannot promote cholesterol. Cholesterol will be increased by animal fat and not by the vegetation fat. So these are things how these the people who want to sell things, who want to earn money, they want to befool the common man. But then every man cannot learn science. Everyone in the society cannot become a scientist. A society will not sustain if everyone is a scientist. But scientific attitude or scientific thinking is a must for every citizen of this planet. Dr. Narinder K. Sehgal, a physicist and Kalinga awardee, he's a leading Indian science communicator. And in his concept paper for the UNESCO, he has argued that some minimum science and technology must be essential for every person, immaterial whether he's practicing science or not. But then we should also understand that having knowledge of science is different from having a scientific attitude. These two are very different things. We know about scientists who may be very good in the laboratory, but outside that, their attitude is not scientific. But scientific attitude is at least as important as knowledge of science, because science shapes attitude and science aims at search for truth. Uncovering or finding out the mysteries of nature and also overpowering and perhaps exploiting the nature for society's good. Welfare of the human race, for example, finding vaccines, finding medicines, alleviating pain, removing poverty, and so on. For all these things, science is a very effective instrument. But many of us have a wrong notion, particularly those who are not from the scientific disciplines. They believe that scientists are all very rational people. They're always thinking of science. They're always scientific in their attitude and so on. They also believe that new things can only be invented or discovered by people who have studied science and earned high degrees in science, but that is not true. People who were virtually illiterate have invented things. Look at the Wright brothers. They were cycle mechanics who perhaps never went to the school, but they invented aeroplanes. Of course, the French people claim that it was done in France, and some people in Odisha claim that it was done in Odisha. But the general consensus is that it was the Wright brothers. They did not go to any university. They did not earn any degrees. Many people believe that a science man or a scientist knows about all fields of science. That is not true. People have doubts about their appearance, that they are always lost. They forget to shave. They always keep beard. Their hair are always disheveled and so on. But it's not so. Nor are scientists always very rational in their attitude. They are not know-all. Look at the statement by Rutherford in 1931. He said, to say that energy can be generated by breaking atoms is talking moonshine. But today we know for so many years that nuclear energy by fission is a reality. Enrico Fermi, the man associated with the first nuclear bomb and a famous nuclear physicist or nuclear scientist, he said, if I were to remember the names of all the elementary particles, I would rather become a botanist. So having a very good memory is also not so essential. People have done wonders without having very great memory. So memory is not the thing. It is basically the approach. The predictions which people make about tomorrow's world can also sometimes can become ridiculous. The chairman of IBM in 1941 said, I think there is a world market for 5 computers. This was said by Thomas Watson in 1941. Bill Gates in 1981 said, who in their right frame of mind would ever need more than 640 kilobytes of RAM? And now the mobile that we have in our pocket has RAM in GB. So future comes very fast. As Professor Sina Rao also said in a lecture at Lucknow, Einstein also said the same thing. And then there was an astonishing statement by Lord Kelvin, the person after whom Kelvin for temperature is used. He was then the president of the Royal Society in London, and he said, heavier than air, flying machines are impossible. Within 8 years of that, the illiterate cycle mechanics proved him wrong. So what I am trying to say is that very often we have or try to give an impression that a scientist knows everything or knows many things or are the only people who can discover things. Now, talking of the scientific temper or scientific thing, I'll tell you an anecdote. The authenticity of the anecdote is not very great. It has been very frequently and very widely quoted, but nevertheless, it's something very interesting. We all have heard of Niels Bohr, the famous physicist. It is said that there was a visitor who went to visit Niels Bohr. And when he reached his place, he saw that a horseshoe magnet was there somewhere near the door. So he asked Niels Bohr, as in India also and in Europe, many people believe that hanging a magnet, a horseshoe magnet, will bring good luck and save the person from many calamities and so on. So he asked Niels Bohr, I never thought that you would believe in such things. You are also keeping it. Bohr said, no, I don't believe in such things. But people tell me that this brings good luck even to those who don't believe in this. So I was trying to tell you that these things, sometimes people also practice things. They may be otherwise very great in their scientific thinking. Many of us have wrong notions about many things in nature and in science. For example, if I have studied physics, I might have very wrong notions about another subject. But sometimes even people who are working in that field have wrong or incorrect notion about certain things. And that is because we don't really go and verify. Today, everybody in this world, everyone who thinks about the climate and this world and the future of planet Earth, he worries about the increasing temperature, so-called global warming. But you would be surprised to know that if we look at the history of Earth over the last 40, 45 crore years, that is almost 440 million years, we are in a phase where the temperature is the lowest. If you look at the curve here, you would see that the temperature right now is lowest during the past 30 years or so. There was an ice house about 29, 30 crore years ago. But after that, temperature was always higher. But now we are living in this phase. These 100 years are very important to us. And therefore, we are worried about these increases, which are genuine, they have been established by measuring the amount of carbon dioxide in the ice cores taken from the poles. People went to the polar areas, they drilled there, they took out ice from there, and they studied the amount of carbon dioxide in the lowest and the middle and the above and the top layer. And they found in mass spectrometer that carbon dioxide has been constantly increasing ever since the industrial activities started on this planet. Similarly, we are talking about the sea level, but you would be surprised that during the past 40 crore years or so, sea level right now is actually the lowest. But yes, if our carbon dioxide and methane or other greenhouse gas concentration goes on increasing in the atmosphere, the sea level will go on increasing, and that's going to be a calamity. But if you look on a geological time scale, we are in the most pleasant time in the history of the Earth. But how do we tell these people to, how do we tell these things to a common man who doesn't understand equations, who cannot read graphs, who is not very computer savvy, and who doesn't go to net very often? For that, popularizing science, making science exhibitions, talking to people about science becomes very important. If you remember, in the year 2004, there was this exhibition. Now, this exhibition was moving all over the country. And this I want to tell you especially because this is the way science should be popularized. The approach of presentation sometimes makes the effect manifold better. Here, the exhibition was organized inside the coaches of a train, and the train was moving all across the country. And this has been done, I think, at least three times. And people came so much so that there has to be a cane charge by the police because the crowd of the people was huge. This was the last day of that exhibition when people just were too many and they could not be controlled. So what I am trying to tell is that those of us who understand science, who have the capability of communicating science, we should always think that packaging science is also equally important for the common man. I will give you an example, very interesting example, which happened in front of our eyes. I was a part of the campaign of Vigyan Prasar, which they were doing for the Atomic Energy Commission on behalf of NPIL, that's the Nuclear Power Corporation of India, NPCL. The point was that in many places, people were opposing nuclear energy. In South, a plant was not allowed to go on because people were told that this would ruin their future. But that was completely wrong. We went to a plant near in Narora, and everything was fine there. There was nothing like contamination. Regular monitoring was there. A lot of greenery was there, but a lot of canard was spread. Then a news appeared, which was very disturbing, in a newspaper, and the report was from Patna in Bihar. It said that because of the radioactive materials being released from the Narora nuclear plant, the water of Ganges was contaminated. And in Bihar, the Ganges was contaminated and the dolphins which were there had turned blind. Now, that is something really very interesting. There are just 1,200 or so Gangetic dolphins left in the world. So it was a serious thing, the accusation. If it were true, then it was a serious thing for the environment and for the people who care for animals and birds and such mammals and other things. But then, you know what turned out? I checked on it and I realized that the dolphin is born blind. So there is no question of any dolphin turning blind because of any radioactive waste coming from the Narora power reactor. They are born blind, they don't have crystalline eyes, they cannot see, they navigate using the sonar waves, but this canard was being spread for very ulterior motive to oppose the nuclear energy. So such things also happen, and then to fight such rumors, the only way is argument and logic. If you remember long back, people did not know what the age of the Earth was. Today we know this is about 4.55, approximately 4.5 billion years. a little less than that of sun. But there was a time when people did not know how old the earth was. So the among the first people, after, of course, religious people, among the physicists, it was Lord Kelvin. And he tried to make calculations. What I'm trying to tell you is that sometimes in reaching conclusions, it's not just the procedure. It's also the hypothesis, which is very important for reaching at a right conclusion. So Lord Kelvin started his calculation in different ways. He first tried to use sun, how much energy was being produced, how much mass it was gaining in the form of comets or meteorites and such thing, and how much it was losing because matter was continuously getting converted into energy. Then he also applied another idea. He said that in the beginning, Earth must have been very hot, and it was cooling like anybody which radiates and cools. And he tried to make calculations, and he concluded that Earth must have taken 10 crore years to cool from its initial to the final temperature. Later, somebody told him that his assumption for the initial temperature of Earth was very high. Then he revised it, and he said it must have taken about 2.5 crore years for Earth to cool to the present temperature. But the geologists were not agreeing. They said that the rate at which things change in today's world may not have changed much from the early days. So based on that, they said that the age of Earth should be much more than a few crore years. But the problem was not solved. It was much later when the radioactivity was known. Isotopes could be used, and isotopes or lead were used to date old terrestrial rocks, and it turned out that the age of Earth was 4.5 billion years. So a physicist started in a very elegant manner, and there was no argument mathematically he was right. So it's not always the tools which one is using. It is also the early hypotheses which are important, and of course, procedures are also important, but then these are fields where more than one discipline is used. Second error was, at that time, radioactivity was not known. He did not know that there are radioactive elements in the core of Earth, which are constantly producing heat. Therefore, Earth is not just cooling. Earth is also gaining energy or heat from the radioactive transformation occurring in its core. Then, in 1976, a spacecraft went. It flew by Mars and it sent a photograph of a face from the surface of Mars. Now this face, as you can see, looks like that of a man. And there were rumors that if there is a several kilometer big face sculpted on the surface of Mars, there must be people on Mars, there must be civilization on Mars who sculpted it. But then 25 years later, another flyby mission was there. It had a better resolution. It was sent by the European Space Agency. They took the photograph from another angle. And that showed that this was a geological structure made by lava. Because they were because there was volcanic activity on Mars. So this shape was sculpted there. And this had nothing to do with any civilization there. So here, what we learn about science approach is that look at a problem from different angles. From one angle, it appeared to be a human face, but from a different angle, it became clear that this was a geological structure because of volcanic activity. Sometimes the logic is wrong, and we reach a wrong conclusion. During the Second World War, people were trying to find out which part of the plane was hit most. So they were trying to see that if we find out which is the most vulnerable part of the plane, we can strengthen it so that we next time don't lose a plane. So all the planes that had come back from the sorties, they examined them and they concluded that certain part in the belly, let us say, belly of the plane was most vulnerable. And they thought that if we strengthen it, then maybe we would save many of our planes from getting bombed and fallen. But then somebody pointed out that there was a flaw in the logic. The flaw was, we are only looking at those planes which have come back. The planes which were actually hit and which were destroyed never came back to us. So our conclusions are based on those planes which have survived and not on those planes which actually were finished in the air by bombing. So the logic was wrong. Similarly, if you look, there was an artist in his paintings, a lot of yellow color was used. So people said that he must be using yellow color because his eyes may not be very sensitive to yellow color. Now, that was seemed to be a very sensible explanation. But then somebody said, you see, he's only making a nature painting. So he's copying yellow color from nature onto his canvas. So he has to just compare the two. So if in nature, the color is yellow, he will make the same color on his canvas. Immaterial of whether his eyesight is good, very sensitive to yellow or not sensitive to yellow. Similarly, somebody said that one artist was making human figures which were very tall and they related it to the problem with his eyesight. But then again, they said that he's looking at other people. He would compare the other people from what he's drawing. And if they are similar, then your logic doesn't hold. So he was purposefully drawing them tall and it was though. So this is the kind of logic which not only when we are talking of art, this is applicable also in science. Every time the month of August comes, you would see in newspaper at least 2005, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, and even after that, you must have read in newspapers that Mars has come very close to Earth. This is fine. Mars, when he's on the our side of the sun, and when on the other side of the sun, the distances are very different by a factor of 7 or 8. And therefore, Mars will look small when it goes on the farther side, and Mars will look comparatively big when it is on the our side. Up to this is fine. But then even the most prestigious newspapers of India, I will not name it, they printed there that tonight you would see Mars in the sky, red and as big as moon. Of course, I immediately wrote back to that journalist and telling her why this could not happen. But why it cannot happen is because the minimum distance of Mars from Earth is approximately 54 million kilometers. This distance is about 140 times that of Moon. If the two were equal, Mars would appear this much smaller because of the distance, which is 140 times farther. But size of Mars is double. That does not make much of a difference. But now, apparent size of Moon is so big, so that even when Mars comes much closer, 7 or 8 times closer compared to the farthest point, even at that time, it cannot appear. Its apparent size or its angular size cannot be bigger than Moon. And this we have been seeing. We have never seen Mars. In fact, we can never see Mars bigger than Moon as long as we are watching from Earth. If you go beyond Mars, somewhere toward Jupiter, then perhaps we can do that. Science has another important power, and that is of calculations, mathematics, astronomy, or such things. Science, when we calculate and we say that eclipse will happen and such time, this generates people's faith in the predictive power of science. People know that something which is happening billions of kilometers away, even that can be calculated and predicted correctly. And that tells them if scientists say something, there is a logic, there is a force of logic behind that. What you see here is Professor J.V. Narlikar, Padma Vibhushan Professor Narlikar. He was in Allahabad in 1995. When we were giving the live commentary on the total solar eclipse. And if you remember before that in 1980 and later, when there was a total solar eclipse, nobody was coming out of the house. But when scientists and media got together, that was a power of communication very well established. People were told that you can look at the solar eclipse through safe means. You can look at the solar eclipse on television. You will not be hurt. Newspapers stopped screaming that get inside your house during the total solar eclipse, otherwise your eyes or your retina would be damaged. All these things were things of the past. And on this occasion, 600 young children from the nearby villages, they came to us listen to our lectures, and next day with safe filters or through projection using our telescope, they were able to see the total solar eclipse. So if the scientists come forward, if the scientists tell the society in a simple manner, in a language which people understand, then people will appreciate science and their faith in what scientists say will be increased. Look at the today's situation. In this COVID-19 pandemic, it's not the God-men who are coming to the help of people. It's the doctors, it's the scientists, it's the pathologist, it's the paramedical staff, it's the other people. Everything else has been closed. It's only the scientists and doctors who are working. When we talk of predictions, people say that in our patras or in our panchangs or in our such ancient things, there are a lot of calculation which very rightly predict the time of eclipses, times of transit. For example, when a small planet passes in front of a star and so on. This is very true. We had very learned people in the past, the rishis, who were very good at calculations, at mathematics. In India, astronomy was very advanced. In India, mathematics was very advanced. More than 1500 years ago, we could solve quadratic equations. More than 1500 years ago, we knew about the value of pi, the relation between radius and circumference of a circle. But that does not mean that Falit Jyotish is necessarily correct. This is like saying you take your age, multiply it by 9, add some number, divide by some number, you will get some number, which may be from 0 to 9. Now, if you get 0 remainder, your future will be like this. If you get 1, the future will be like this. So this is not something which science would support. But then there are some people who really believe it to be true. But then some people abroad and also in India studied how truthful the horoscopes are. Astronomy, we all know, is observational science. It makes exact calculation. It finds out orbits, the time of eclipses, times of other celestial events, and so on. And astronomy provides input to the astrology, but how far astrology is true is very difficult to say now. I will not dwell much on it, but I can give you some names, Sean Carlson and Michael Gauquelin. They are some people, they're French, for example, Gauquelin is a French person. They took a lot of horoscopes. They sent it to people without telling them and then asked them, what is your reading about this person? And in majority of cases, it was not possible to find the correct characteristics of that person based on horoscope. In India, not many such studies are done, but Professor Nalikar mentioned one such study last year when I was attending a conference in Kolkata. He said that 100 Janapatris were distributed and people were learned people, I mean, people who were good, supposed to be good at this art or science, they predicted their characteristics, their future, their nature, their intelligence, and so on. And this turned out to be a failure, a random thing, just like you might find 50% right, 50% wrong. But then, if something is happening, it must be true. There are many people who are in our country, they believe that this is true. So what I feel is there is a need to carry out very systematic or scientific study in this. And there are instances done even in the European countries. For example, in Amsterdam University, they studied the football players or the soccer players. And they found that they were more likely to have been born during September and November months. Now, if this is happening, this must be true. That means the time of birth may be important. Then Weber at the Vienna University, he studied the soldiers in the army. And he found that those who were born during the month of March and month of May were on average taller by 6 millimeters compared to the other. That means the time of birth may be important. But this is something which we do not know for certain. And science is a subject where last word is the last word. We go by the current evidence. If Newton said something, we believed in it. We even were able to reach rockets to moon. But when Einstein came, For microscopic world, Einstein's say was true. When we come to a smaller time scale, in smaller sizes and so on in the micro world, then Newton's law may not be fully valid. And science progresses by demolishing an old theory. If something is proved wrong, science becomes stronger. In science, particularly in the medical science, in food science, keep changing. And that is one difficulty we are facing today. Today, they say that tomato is very good for health. Next year, somebody publishes a paper, this can cause cancer. Then another paper comes which says something different. So this change in science is based on evidence. This power of evidence is the strongest thing for science. So one last example I'll give you of the power of logic, which we can say scientific thinking, something like 12, 13 years ago, you might have heard of an incident called Munochwa, or the face scratcher. In Sitapur, in Barabanki, in Varanasi, and in several other places, there were rumors that there is some kind of thing. Nobody knew whether it was an animal or a human being or some kind of a ghostly thing, which would come, scratch the face of the people, and then go away. And this became such a serious problem that in Barabanki, there was firing. In some places, the electrical lines were set on fire. So the commissioner sent a message to the regional science city, who approached me, and we went to a place called Biswa in Sitapur, which is about 70 kilometers from Lucknow. And once we went there, we started talking to people, and then we realized that there is something wrong. People are trying to cook up things. What they said was, I'll give you just one or two examples because it's a long story. I have published it. You can look at it in the paper. When we talked to one person, he said there, he saw a light. Light was coming towards him. And when it got close to him, it came to its feet, then started going up, started going up, started going up. And finally, it reached his head and started dancing. Now, I knew that the person was lying, but how to say? I asked him, I can understand that you could look at it when it was on the legs, feet, on the chest, or here, but once that light went above your eye level, how did you see that? When it reached your head, how did you see that? How did you know that it was dancing? Now, that person was flabbergasted. He looked around and he saw that everybody was laughing, because everyone knew that he was telling a cock and bull story, and this was not true. Another person told another story that a black dog came and jumped, and then all those stories he said. Then he showed the scratches on his forearm. He said, there are a lot of scratches here. I counted, there were 15. Interestingly, the scratches were like this, and then crisscross this, and then another set of scratches. I asked him, how many times did the dog scratch you? He said, once. I said, at most, he could have scratched your arm with both paws. How many marks can it make maximum? 10. How did you get 15 marks? And how is it that those are, a dog can never put both his, all the 10 claws together. So how do I find them crisscrossing? It's just impossible. And the way it was discussed, everyone around him knew that the man was telling a lie, and you will not believe that whole of Biswa, which had been disturbed terribly for the last 3 weeks, became normal the very next day. So the power of logic, the power of reason, it was covered in a lot of newspapers. Vidyut substation par tod phod aagjani ke aarop mein 5 banti. Our lesser beings behind Munochwa scare. Injuries are self-inflicted. This was said by the SSP after I went there. I explained these things, and then people were convinced that there is nothing like Munochwa, and the whole city came to normal, and problems in Barabanki also subsided. Of course, it was only after coming back, when I saw the photograph in the next day in the newspaper, I realized how serious the situation was. At that time, I was so focused, I had not looked at the people around. There were hundreds of people gathered there, and I think some of them could have been very offensive people also, but luckily, nothing happened. And this is the man, the old man, which you see here in the figure. He's the one who was telling that story. Many other story, but all with very simple logic, with very logical thinking, very scientific thinking, we discussed and the problem was sorted out. So what we want is that science should reach common man. Science should reach this little boy in Sultanpur who is looking at a fossil of which he knows nothing. He is curious. If you make a child curious at this stage, at this age, then the child is likely to become a person with curiosity in later years. And this is very important for the rural areas where there is most of the Indian population lives. If those people become curious, if those people's curiosity is satisfied, they may later grow up to become scientists and they may solve the problems which face a rural folk today, rather than only the city bred people who are in science most of the times. So the goal of science teaching in our universities and colleges should not be just imparting knowledge or information, but the method of science, as Professor Taneja said right in the beginning, is a method of science which is the most important thing. Rather than cramming formulae, they should understand the meaning. And if they do that, I think the people will become better scientists, and those who don't become scientists will become better citizens. So logic is something very important. And even in our ancient practices, there are a lot of things like sutak, which is foreign time. But then a science communicator or a scientist should also learn to distinguish between harmless culture, harmless practices, and those practices which are bad, bad for the society. There are certain things which are done for psychological reasons. I mean, if somebody applies a tikka on my forehead, I feel good. I mean, we don't have to go to find the reason whether it presses. If you can find it, it's fine. But even if it's not there, things which have sentimental value, things that have emotional value, they will still be important in the society. But if there are harmful superstitions where one doesn't go for treatment instead of goes for the jhadphuk, then this is bad. But people are a mix of logic, of emotions, of sentiments, of relationship. All these things a science communicator must keep in mind, and with that scientific logic, he can go ahead. So in conclusion, we may say that we need science and scientific attitude as much. One should look at it as an adversary of culture. Science is not adversary of culture, or even of religion for that matter. Science does not know everything, at least today. So no need for confrontational attitude with culture or religion or everything. Another very important thing is not all that is old is bad, and not all that is new is good, or vice versa. There are many things in our ancient practices which were very good, but not everything was good. Many things that appeared impossible 20 years ago are happening today. So when we say something was happening in the past, this is not necessarily wrong, but this is not necessarily right either. So let us not peddle the claims without evidence, because that makes us ridiculous. We should examine things. We should, based on others' knowledge, for example, science communicators like me, we very often say that, okay, Lord Buddha has also said that believe in, just don't just believe something because your teacher has said, test it. But I have never tested or tasted potassium cyanide. I believe in the knowledge which is already there. So there are many things which someone else has studied and established. We value them, we take them as established science, we add to that, and that is how science progresses. But there are domains where science is unable to intervene. So let us not push science everywhere, but a scientific attitude will be good for our environment, for our society, and for our humanity. Thank you so much for a very patient listening.
Thank you, sir. In the chat box, I have got one question. And anyone else, if interested in asking any question to the speaker, please write it in the chat box so that we can take those questions. So I have seen one question in the chat box. I am coming on that question. The question from Ekta, she has asked that which field in science will got an exponential growth in next decade?
Which field in science has got?
which field in science will got an exponential growth in next decade?
I understand the question. It's a good question, but I am, of course, not a Jyotishi. But my guess is that biological sciences are going to be very important in the coming few decades. And second thing, very soon, I believe that the distinction between different disciplines will go on vanishing. Already, we are seeing biophysics, we are seeing biochemistry, we are seeing nuclear physics and nuclear chemistry, we are seeing geochronology, which is a mix of physics and geology. So I think in the coming few decades, and even in the new education policy, there is more liberty given. And I feel that biology will grow tremendously. In the physical sciences, I see a lot of scope for nanotechnology or material science. Computers, of course, there will be some quantum jump in the computers also. We will not be having such huge laptops or such huge screens and all. So technology will also grow in leaps and bounds. But biosciences, I think, next few decades perhaps will belong to biosciences.
I think the student has got the answer. Anyone else?
I feel Professor Khare should be answering this question.
Okay, sir, you have nicely presented the theme of the lecture, that is the scientific attitude and the importance that everyone should develop a scientific attitude, and in such a way that when we see something or when we find something in the news or some in personal interaction, we must any kind of any incidents. Yes, but I am getting one more question. Is there, by Jaydev Sharma, is there any established relation between spiritual science and physical science?
Many people believe that spiritual science begin where our material or these physical sciences end. I don't know. Spirit is, as I said, that there are certain things which are beyond the domain of present science. I think spiritual science or spirituality is one thing. Nobody denies its psychological value. This is something really great that way. But I don't think there is really a relation established between these material or physical sciences and spirituality. We are still far from that.
Nice, sir. As you have said in your during the lecture, that in the science, that's also true. We say that the last word is the last word. Something what we observed finally, or something what we established finally, we say this is true. Something which is not explained, we generally deny. And that is what is happening. And that creates a very fine line between superstitions and many things which later on realize that they have some values. So in last four, five years, if you look, people have started thinking a different way also. One example I can easily quote, that if you go back for 15 years or 20 years back, we used to see an ad from the Colgate. And in that, they used to see so that there was a namak and tel oil they were using, and they were saying, no, you should not use it. This is very harmful. And now we are realizing that something which were told later as harmful is not harmful, it's useful. So the question comes that how we distinguish these two, that something which is being propagated as a science is true, or something which is actually propagated is the propaganda, not the science. How we can distinguish these two?
Yeah, this is something really very difficult, very difficult. And we try to go by the latest available evidence. This has happened even in the case of COVID-19. For example, in case of COVID-19, earlier it was said that it cannot spread through air. But then it was realized actually experiments were done with the mannequins and putting mask on their face and so on, and it was realized no, it can go. Then they said that it's possible for it to spread for 6 feet, and now they have said it can spread up to 20 feet if it's small. If this is get attached to the aerosols, which are a few microns in size, less than 5 microns in size, it can travel even farther. So in science, we go by the latest available evidence, and sometimes results can be reversed. In food science, this is happening because body is a very complex system. It's a very complex system, and there are a lot of interfering processes going on. So in the laboratory, when an experiment is done, it's like in chemistry, there can be interfering radicals. So similarly, in the human body also, when you study in the laboratory, you study the reaction between just two things. But in a body, there are a lot of interfering things. So second thing is these commercial companies, they can mislead you. There is some kind of funded or sponsored research. I'm sure that about coffee and chocolate. They do some dummy research, and then they send it to not to the research papers, not to the research journals. They send it to newspapers that our results prove that it can enhance your concentration. It can enhance the energy level in your body and so on. In case of oil, you can see that oil is a vegetable product. If oil is a vegetable product, then it will have triglyceride and not cholesterol. But if this is an animal fat, then it will have cholesterol. So it's obvious that the two are exclusive. If you take animal fat oil, you will be getting cholesterol. If you are taking it from the plant-based oil, you will be getting triglyceride and not cholesterol. But they printed it as if they have devised some kind of new oil which is free from cholesterol. So these are the marketing gimmicks. I do not know of any foolproof way, but I think the scientists who are working in the laboratories, when they hear of such claims, they should do something. They should do these experiments for the public interest and come up with the results.
Thank you, sir. We have got one more question from our MSc student, Avista Dyagi.
Yeah.
Is perfect knowledge has biggest role in any invention or the idea and logic, as if we have less knowledge, but logics are right?
Please repeat the question.
Is perfect knowledge has biggest role in any invention or the idea and logic, as if we have less knowledge, but logics are right?
I think second is more valid. Einstein has said that I was not particularly intelligent. He also said that I was curious. So for invention particularly, it's not essential to have huge knowledge, even if somebody has a limited knowledge, but it's relevant. And his logic is perfect and he's imaginative. Einstein said knowledge is always limited, whereas imagination is unlimited. So even with a small amount of knowledge, if one uses imagination, one will be able to do inventions. So more than knowledge, it's one's curiosity, one's intelligence, and one's creativity or imagination, which is important for inventions.
Thank you, sir. Professor Khave want to speak something?
Yeah.
So, that's Yasin, Professor Khave. Sir. Please unmute.
Yeah, he can speak.
I just want to point out that there is nothing like absolute truth.
Yes.
It can change. We derive many things out of our experiments, out of our experiences, and make a theory. And that we say that this theory should work. But as soon as we realize that it is not working in that way, we discard.
Change the theory.
And try to get something new, which can also explain that point also. So this is how we progress. But to say that we can find an absolute truth is probably still beyond us.
Extreme, beyond us. Yes, I agree, sir.
We should continue our effort in that direction.
Yes, sir. Perfectly true. Perfectly true.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. I don't see any more questions.
So yes, at sir. The end, I would like to thank the speaker once again for this nice and useful talk. Now I request Dr. Yogen Gautam for the formal vote of thanks. Dr. Gautam.
Thank you, Professor Ramesh Kumar. Good evening to all of you. I, on the behalf of our organizing committee and entire team of physics department, extend a very hearty vote of thanks to our honorable Vice Chancellor, sir, Professor N. K. Taneja, who blessed us with his presence and took out valuable time of his busy schedule. We are deeply grateful for your constant motivation, encouragement, support, and keen interest in all such academic activities. Thank you so much, sir, for a very interesting and thought-provoking address that will definitely inspire us. Also, it is a great privilege to thank our invited speaker, Dr. Chandra Mohan Nautiyal, a renowned physicist. His insightful lecture on science and scientific temper, Vigyan Tatha Vigyanik Soch, was full of wisdom and information. Dr. Nautiyal very well explained the science and technology discoveries given by ancient India to this world. He shared with us several examples and tips to make optimal use of mind power and inner potential to understand the science and improve our scientific temper to help the society. I believe that all the participants have learned a lot from you, and it will surely be beneficial. Once again, I thank you, sir, for giving your precious time for all of us. I would also express my profound gratitude to our Vice Chancellor, Madam Professor Y. Vimala, who graced us with her presence. I also thank you, ma'am, for your constant support, guidance in all our such activities. I'm also thankful and happy to our respected Professor S.P. Khare. Your presence has immensely enhanced the importance of this lecture. I also thank our respected Dean of Faculty of Science, Professor M.K. Gupta, for his presence in this lecture and his all-time motivation and guidance. I can see Professor Sudhir Kumar Sharma. Professor Sudhir. Gupta and many more faculty of university and colleges for showing your interest in this lecture and acceptance our invitation. I'm very grateful to our head of the department and convener of this lecture series, session to you for giving us an opportunity to organize and listen this memorable lecture today. I also wish to express my gratitude to Dr. Anuj Kumar, organizing secretary, for organizing this wonderful lecture and making all necessary Kumar Malik for giving nice and the Department of Research and Academic Activities. And of course, big thanks to the wonderful participants who have turned up in large numbers, and not only from our department, but also from the other department of the university and colleges. We thank you so much for your cooperation and showing your interest in the lecture series and today's lecture. I'm very thankful to Dr. Kavita Sharma for making arrangement of Saraswati Vandana with our student, Ms. Lavista, and of course, your constant support to organize this lecture and all academic events in the department. I thank Dr. Upadesh Verma for making Zoom meeting arrangement. And sir, you always help us to carrying out such important events to the department and university. My sincere thanks to other members of the organizing committee, Dr. Sanjeev Kumar Sharma, Dr. Anil Kumar Yadav, and the students of the department and staff members. And this event could not have been successful without them. And I'm also thankful to all the members of the media for evincing interest in covering the event. Once again, I thank you all for your kind attention and making this invited lecture successful. Thank you so much. I'll hand over to Dr. Anuj Kumar.
Thank you, Dr. Yogen. Thanks everyone who have attended and spared their valuable time. Now I would like to request Honorable Vice Chancellor, sir, to permit us to close this meeting.
It's all right.
Thank you, sir. Dr. Updes, please.
One more thing, like many people are asking about the certificates and feedback forms. So actually this lecture is for the knowledge purpose only. So we are not providing any certificates. So thank you very much to all.
Thank you.